Welcome, my friends. This is Maniacal Incorporated, and you join me at the start of a new series on Warsim, the Realm of Aslona. Now, how would I describe this game? I think Warsim can be best described as a cross between the Crusader Kings franchise and a period of detention at a psychiatric facility. It is a text-based ASCII kingdom management sim. You are the new ruler of a kingdom. You decide how you came to power. Was your father the previous ruler? Did you seize the kingdom in a show of strength? Maybe the demonic overlord installed you as a puppet through which he will now try to take over the entire world. You have to manage the finances of the kingdom, raise money by instituting land taxes, bank taxes, tax taxes to tax taxes, so that taxes generate more taxes. You can force people to wear hats. You can throw people in prison for telling bad jokes. And as the name insinuates, you wage war against the randomly generated kingdoms that surround you. There's a tremendous level of depth to this game. And the dev, Hugh Millward, very kindly sent me on a key a few months back, because he'd seen me playing Dwarf Fortress on Twitch and on YouTube, which was a bit of an inspiration for this game. So he thought I might enjoy it, and very kindly just sent on a key and said if I got around to playing it, all well and good, and if not, no bother. I played it for a while on Twitch, and we had great fun with it. Twitch chat had great fun. And I'm finally getting around to making something for YouTube. I wanted to do a series with a while, and I'm glad it's taken me so long, because recently Hugh has added two new updates to the game. The first was necromancy, and the second was more necromancy. So at the very least, we can now resurrect dead champions. We might entirely be able to form undead armies as well. And I think there are also some of the kingdoms around us could potentially be necromancers. So the easiest thing to do is start into it. So we're going to start a new game, and we've tons and tons and tons of options. We can decide to just have random races. So these will be the other races populating the world that we will be in. We could select races, and that includes human races, that includes Tolkien-like races. You can have complete custom packs. We're just going to go with the random races. So we'll pull from a list of 94 million races to make a unique world. You're going to have a lot of time and effort to try and see all of those. I'm going to leave it up to fate. And we're going to just play a short game. We're going to do 25 years. Now, you could have no time limit. Basically, after 25 years, the game will end. You can continue on if you want to. But it's kind of, this was your term of office. The music can get a bit loud, so I'm just going to leave the menu theme on, which is pretty much what's going on in the background at the moment, and accept the currently selected music. And here we choose if we will be known as King, Queen, or something else. We're going to go with a custom title. And we will go with Chief Executive Officer. And I'll put that in for this title as well. And we'll be just known as Mr. So lots of customization options. Random masculine name. Fenor the Greatest. I like that. We're going to be known... We won't be known as Fenor the Greatest. There's a reason we won't be known as Fenor the Greatest. I want a different masculine name. Raelith the Anguished. Bunduk, son of Stighard. Marcus Meathook. Do you know what that is? That is probably the easiest one to pronounce at the moment. Marcus Meathook. We would accept that. And again, we can either make our own kingdom name, a random kingdom name, or choose the default, Aslona. We'll go to random kingdom name to see what it'll throw out to us. Your kingdom will be called War Clanlands. I want a different name. Deathhold. Yes. And I'm just going to go with the normal start. Right. You are the ruler of the kingdom of Deathhold, once a great and mighty empire, fighting against the powerful rebellion of Faradel the Kinslayer, and the hordes of bandits loyal to Fëanor, that's why I didn't go with the Fëanor name, overlord of the bandit horde, as well as several minor bandit gangs who pester your lands. The world is vast and complex. There is much to see and do, and little time to waste. From the fabled ancient lands to the blood-soaked arena, these lands call to be united under the flag of Deathhold. So what it's now going to do is it's going to generate the world. It's going to generate the tribes that are going to be around us, a number of independent kingdoms. There's a pirate community, Cogroar's domain, the majestic Dune Shades. So there we go. After a few moments, we have the world. The world is full of mystery and wonder. There are many people in this world. They are men, pirate Gilghouls, lava, corpse lords, majestic Dune Shades, furious taiga minotaurs, shadow fungus folk, goblins, and demons. And you could have had an option if you wanted to re-roll those, but I'm happy enough with what we have. The annals of history. Remember well your rise to the throne. How did it happen? So here we have all these options. I pulled a fabled sword from the stone. My enslaved forces were able to overthrow the previous ruler. I led a slave revolt. The previous ruler died of old age. My father, the previous ruler. We're going to go with... Where is it gone to? Number 4, I won the throne in a bet with the previous ruler. So basically a hostile takeover. We're a chief executive officer, and we have purchased the kingdom. So the previous chief executive officer had run the company into debt and crossed paths with you, a wealthy gambler and opportunist. You offered your entire wealth of gold against the title of chief executive officer with a coin flip. The desperate CEO took the risk and lost, and then surrendered the realm to you in a move that became the talk of the realm. So we have 12,500 extra gold from our personal reserve, minus 15 public opinion due to our origin, and one third of our army has deserted and joined the rebellion because they're not impressed with the way that we have come to power. We are invited to the royal crowning ceremony, where we can learn of our newly inherited realm. Let's go to the ceremony. There you go. We're heralded into the room. You enter what is now your throne room. For the first time, there are small crowds of people who are gathered to see their new chief executive officer. As you take a moment to observe the room, the High General of Deathhold approaches. So this is General Goren Pikner, who is pretty much the same every run that you do. So he's a kind of a static NPC, would you call him that? Greetings to you. I hope that you are well. I shall crown you as the one true chief executive officer of Deathhold. You gained this title through a bet with the previous CEO, who is now poor and fortuneless. Though many have revolted against your crowning, we as noble servants of the crown must stand behind you. You are now the chief executive officer of Deathhold. Long may you reign. Now, as is our silly little tradition, we must do something. Bring the slap-ready goblin. A goblin walks into the throne room and is informed you will be slapping him. So all of these ASCII faces are procedurally generated, from what I can understand. Or there is at the very least a memory bank of potentially tens of thousands of them. The goblin leans forward and waits expectantly. You slap the goblin. The general grins and says, "Good slap!" And that brings our ceremonious ceremony to an end. And that is how you become a chief executive officer. Now, you will no doubt wish to know the state of the realm. Deathhold's 5 territorial holdings make us a threat to others. The kingdom's personal army consists of, a number most foul to Irishmen. Execute one of them, the way I have some chance of pronouncing it. So we have a number of peasants, and we have a chunk of loyal knights who will serve our cause. So that's the military matters. As for the financial state of the realm, we were able to preserve 2,000 in the kingdom's coffers. And you also have 2,982 in the bank reserves. Sometimes the previous ruler leaves the entire realm empty of gold. So your starting gold for this option is random, really, so we actually have a solid amount of gold. And now that we've been crowned, we can talk to Old Kroll and get some extra hints and tips. If it's your first time playing this, I would strongly advise that you go and speak to them. It's of no use whatsoever. It's not in any way helpful. It's hilarious, but it's not helpful. It is kind of helpful. It's more hilarious than helpful is the way I should have put it. But, yeah, definitely go and talk to them if it's your first time playing. Your diplomat nods and bows and says that if there's anything else, that we can find them in the throne room. And here is the menu that we are going to spend most of our time in. For this episode, I'm not going to go down through this in depth, but I'm going to go down through this in much more depth than I will in previous years. So I might only get through 1 year in this episode and future episodes then. I might try and do like 4 years an episode or 4 to 5 years an episode. So where will we start? Where will we start? I think the first thing that we will do, we've just gotten to the throne. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to pay a visit to the Royal Bank. So you currently have 2,982 stored in the bank. The interest rate is 0.25% per year because of the kingdom size and the lack of a bank tax. So if we institute a bank tax, that's going to decrease our potential interest. So we could inquire about a loan, we could raid the bank, entirely possible that we could raid the bank. I think what I will do is I'll deposit another 2,500. Because we did get a chunk of money there at the start. So we're now making 13 gold per year. This getting interest this way probably isn't the easiest way of making money, but I do like to have some money in the bank. A rainy day fund. We have kingdom reports, we have the grand arena. I think the first thing we'll do is we will go to the throne room. So we have 19 visitors waiting at the moment, and what we could do is we could appoint a steward to meet all of these instead. So we have 19 for the year. So here is our throne room, and I will appoint a steward now at some stage. And they warn us to be wary of who we appoint as steward, because we're going to have all these different types of people, and not just people, arriving in our throne room. And depending on who we have as steward, they will treat them differently. So a goblin friend will always be nice to goblin visitors, even maybe when they shouldn't be. Now, I'm not going to go through this in depth every year, but we're going to take a look at some of the petitioners that arrive at our throne room. You are visited by an insane person who says, the hero will forever squirm, but tastes much nicer than the worm. We could send him to the dungeons. Thank him for his words. The man bows and leaves. Send in the next visitor. You are visited by a traveling bard. He asks to show you the singing ways of the old orcish. I'm pretty good at this. I shall play you a lengthy song. First thing we'll do is we'll ask him his origins. I am a commoner, but I do enjoy music. I play when I can. We will ask him his name. The Grunther reveals his name to be Cash Tullerts. Let us listen to the song. The Grunther nods and prepares to play for you. So the Musicians Guild, which is a guild in the game, they are now on better relations with us because we have decided to listen to this grunting orc. The Grunther looks at you for your reaction. I can tell you, I was not prepared for that the first time that that happened. I believe all of the music and song performed in this, and all of the voice acting was done by the dev, by Hugh. So we could say that that was a great performance. That was such a great performance. Pay him a bonus of 50 gold. That was bad. You should quit music forever. That was acceptable. I'm going to say that was a good performance. It was a great performance. The Grunther nods and says thanks. And you know what? Let's offer to have him join our staff. The Grunther says he will work for 29 gold and tells you his skill level is 91. So he's a decent Grunther. 29 gold for a 91. Do you know what? Let's hire him for the crack. I think we have to pay him that every year. We have tons of money. We're rolling in money. So we have more reputation with the Musicians Guild. Send in the next visitor. You are visited by a townsman who enters the throne room with three boys following him. Hail and well met. I bring you my sons. My lineage is strong. We are the strongest in our village. I let you have my boys for your army, but only at 50 gold per head. So we could pay the 150. We could forcefully enlist the children and pay nothing. Refuse the offer. To the dungeons with him, or to the dungeons with them all. 50 quid is a bit pricey. But we do need the recruits at this stage. Sure. Perfect, the man says before bowing. So our gold has gone down 150 and our soldiers have gone up by 3. We'll do one or two more of these. You are visited by a traveling bard. He asks to whistle you an old gnomish tune for a price of 80 gold. We just hired somebody. I would like to listen to some gnomish whistling. Do you know what? I don't think I've heard of gnomish whistling before. He comes from the Grand Guild of Musicians of to the west of here. And his name is Melwood. He looks like a Melwood. That's a Melwood face. This is a pricey ask. I could hire a couple of young lads for the army at this rate. We'll listen to him. Bit of an old dance drone in there as well, boys, oh boys. We'll tell him it was a great performance. We'll tell him it was a great performance, and he's happy out, and we will let him leave the court. Right, we'll do one more just to see what the hell is actually going on. So these are the other types of options that you can get then. Visited by an old man who asks if you could spare a few coins. So we'll give him a few. Laughs and leaves. I'm wondering if that old man was genuine. I think they're taking advantage of the new chief executive officer. But our public opinion isn't at the best, so maybe we do want to try and appease these people. I'm going to go down through the rest of the visitors, and then if anything interesting pops up, I'll take a look at it, and other than that, then we will move on to the next part of running our kingdom. So that is all of our visitors dealt with. Recruited a few peasants who offered to join the army. Recruited a lava corpse walker and damaged relations with their kingdom. I'll see that now in a moment. I gained one public opinion by being nice to somebody and then lost it by imprisoning somebody else. We have a number of other options here. We could upgrade the room, upgrade the throne room. Tell the guards that we're no longer seeing visitors. Call a meeting. We won't deal with any of that just for now. And what we might as well do is look at the diplomacy and see what the world around us is like. So we're at war with the rebels and we're at war with the bandit horde. There are two goblin kingdoms that we're at war with, so I believe those four options are pretty much always the same. You're always going to have the kingdom of Krut and Erak. You're always going to start at war with the bandits and with the rebels. Then there are independent territories. There's the Deathhold Militia. There are some adventurer groups, some bandit groups. And there's a goblin slaver. Let's take a look at the independent territories. So there's the pirate community. There is Cogroar's Domain. There's the Masterdom of the Majestic Dune Shades, who we are at war with. Stoneheart Blood Clan, who we are at war with. And Mushinga. So we can go down through all of these and take a look at all of them. There is the flag at the top of the pirate community. It is led by Master Wormface the Enlightened. And they have 2,500 units, so they are fairly strong. Now we could potentially, they have 7 lands, we could potentially try and enter into some trade and diplomacy with them. So there is Wormface himself. Oh boys, that's a... He's living up to that name. He's living up to that name. So, faction relation is 3. Let's see if we can form a trade agreement. that you need to do more to gain his trust. He won't trade with just anyone, needs at least 10 relations, and we have 3, so we have a bit of work to do. We could send him a gift of gold, we might hold off on that for the moment. And there are then a full list of locations that are connected with them. This is all procedurally generated. The Jarell Castle is a large and well-defended castle under the rule of the pirate community and provides them with several more pirate Gilgul Sea Stalkers per year. We will exit that for now. So we will take a look at Cogroar. So there is their flag at the top. Units, 916. Now they are Lava Corpse Lords, so even though they have a smaller amount of units, they may actually be quite powerful. And there is Cogroar, the Skull Carver. So they do not wish to speak with us, as they are very xenophobic. Oh well, there won't be any trade done there. And then we are at war with the other groups. Let's just take a quick look at who we are at war with. So the Majestic Dune Shades, we have -8 relations with them. We can look at their leader information. So there's the battle score, so their own battle score for the individual themselves. And basically units have a battle score, and that's used in determining the victor of the various different battles that are going to go on. Oh, there's going to be some battles in a moment, don't worry about that. And let's see who else we have. Here we have the Stoneheart Blood Clan, and we have Mushinga. We could attempt to try and form peace with these groups, the Shadow Fungus Folk. So we are surrounded by enemies on all sides. Personality stupid. We are surrounded by enemies on all sides. Right. Let's see what we can do. Our main threats, I think, are going to be the rebels and the bandits. So here is Faradel, the Kinslayer. Was the noble prince of Deathhold, nephew to the king who came before you. And the one, or one of those in line to the throne until the king lost a bet with you. Furious at the loss of his family's legacy, Faradel has pledged to have you dethroned, and many join him in agreement. The devil, the absolute devil. So down to the militia. That's where we'll start. You call forth the head of the militia, Brokehoof of the Bloodied Hand, who arrives eager to hear what you have to say. So we could give the militia orders, check the militia stats, speak with the militia leader, build upgrades to the militia. Now, how the militia works is they're a kind of an independent unit that gets divided across, they're a defensive unit that gets divided across all of the territories in the kingdom. So the larger we can make them, the more units per territory there will be, but the larger the kingdom becomes, then the lower the number of units that we're going to have. So the militia is a group of loosely organized peasants from your realm, ordered to help your own troops defend the lands or to stay out of the way. When hiring peasants from the higher troops menu, you are hiring them for the militia. If you hire them all, the militia temporarily disbands until more men join. So basically, peasants will join the militia, and then from the militia, we can join them into the main army and use them for offensive purposes, but that will then decrease the kingdom's defenses. So let's see about building some upgrades for the militia. And I think this is what our first couple of years will primarily be concerned with, is attempting to bolster our defenses. So we could put down a recruitment sign to get more recruits per year for 500 quid. Absolutely, why not? Recruits needed! So a 0 to 1 additional militia join per land owned per year, and I believe we have 5 lands at the moment. And of course what we can then do is get a bigger militia recruitment sign. Do we want to go and get the old weapon stash? I think we might leave that for now. So we haven't done a whole heap with the militia. Actually, while we're here, we'd better go and talk to Barak the Goblin Slaver. You invite the local Goblin Slaver to the throne room to discuss business. We could speak to him. We could ask him who he is. He captures and sells goblins for profit. And we have a couple of other different options there that we can go down through. We can see that he has 29 total goblins, so we can actually buy these from a different region, but we can see that he's generous, pays twice the normal tribute, so we will get tribute for allowing him to operate. And we have adventurer groups as well. I don't think we need to focus on them too much at the moment. As you can see, like I said, there is a significant amount of depth in the game. There is a lot going on. So we have a fellowship. We could approach these guys. They appear to be lava corpse walkers. They are indeed. Or lava corpse lords who engage in slavery. They are wary of us, but not outright hostile. So we could summon them to our court. We could try and fight them if they're causing trouble. But we could try and summon them. But we can't summon these guys because we lack emissaries. So we'll get emissaries. But we can send them out on quests for us. So we've pretty much as much done in diplomacy that we can at the moment. We do have a couple of bandit groups. Do we need to watch them? Your diplomat tells you that there are various bandit gangs in the realm. You may also wish to know more. So, the many-bannered gatekeepers. We have a truce with the grey-bannered frost butchers. The Evil Dawn Cavalry. They sounded cool. We should have actually gone to them. So, you can see that we can pay them off to try and get them to stop raiding us, and they will raid us at various different times, and our militia can be used to defend against them. And 980 bandits and 85 warlords, there's a significant amount of forces arrayed against us. Right, we had better get into the process of recruiting, selling, and disbanding troops. So we're going to hire some units. And we can look at hiring peasants, who we would be hiring from the militia. We can hire soldiers, knights, bandits, goblins, and other hireable units. Let's see about hiring some goblins. So hire tribal goblins from the Goblin Slaver. 3 gold each. And there's 29 available. And we currently have 0. We will hire... Do you know what, one? We'll hire the 29 of them. The Goblin Slaver brings forth the requested goblins and breaks their chains, pointing at you and saying, "This is your master now." So we have the beginnings of a goblin militia. And there are places in the world where we can get more goblins. Let us look at hiring some soldiers. So as you can see, these are ever so slightly more expensive. We currently have 139, so do you know what? We'll hire 11. So that's 429... gold coins. We could hire peasants, but we'll be hiring those out of the local militia for 3 gold. So I might leave the militia alone. And what else do we want to do? Hire some knights. 374 per knight. So that is pricey. And what about the bandits? Hire bandits from the prison. Prison master is brought before you, offers to trade imprisoned bandits who are ready to fight and pillage for a price of 10 gold per head. He has a total of 10 prisoners available. You currently have one bandit in your ranks who joined us in the court. So do you know what? Go on, we'll hire the 10 of them. And then we can look at other hireable units. At the moment we don't have knowledge of any, but we can actually find areas where there are other units to hire. We could sell units, disarm, or convert. We will look at recruitment upgrades. So a bigger militia recruitment sign. A nobility post, which would give us a 1 in 20 chance of recruiting a knight each turn. Small market. Unit prices are 10% more likely to drop. I think what we might do is actually stick down the lot. Your militia needs you. So that was the militia sign that I was planning on not actually getting a while ago. There's a nobility post. And we will get that small market favor as well. Seems though it's cheap. So quite a big expenditure. We don't need to look at the troop wages at the moment. We can manage staff and champions. Change laws of the land. We won't get into that just yet. We have the kingdom upgrades. So we have a variety of different places that we can upgrade as part of the kingdom upgrades. So recruitment signs, more recruits per year. Do you know what? It's cheap. We might as well get it. So slightly less people visiting to join you in the throne room, but up to one extra soldier recruited per land owned each year. And there's the militia old weapon stash. So this is kind of where we can get all of the upgrades, a single window showing us all of the upgrades. Guard genital protection plates. Your guards can't be hitting the balls. Now, do you know what? It's cheap. We're in the economic buildings, or the income buildings. I'll take the tribute collection boxes, but the only person actually playing as tribute at the moment is the goblin slaver, so we're not exactly gonna make much money from that for a while. The productivity buildings. So we can try and increase our farms. They are quite pricey, however. They are quite pricey. So we need to get some money together. And how are we going to get money together? Well, we'll do what we do best. We will gamble. You enter the Grand Arena, one of the core parts of your society. Here, warriors battle and locals pay to watch. The arena is owned by a loyal local named Baldur. The Unrepentant, that's a good name. I wonder if he has a gate named after him. And the entry fee to watch a fight is 21 gold. However, Baldur, the Unrepentant, has informed his staff not to charge you any fees out of respect. So we could watch a fight. We could bet on a fight. We could grand champion. We could visit the Hall of Fame. We could attack the arena. We will speak to a local patron about the arena. Who's the current grand champion? I forget. Well, there you go. Let's check who the local grand champion is. Borkval, the Unhealthy, is the current grand champion of Deathhold. Having recently assumed the title, he has no wins to his name, but will soon fight his debut fight as grand champion. So we'll exit from that for the moment. We will speak to Baldur. You are greeted by the owner, named Baldur the Unrepentant. Hail and well met. How can I help, he asks. So, we could say a variety of different things to him. We could ask to buy the place. And it's 75,000 gold. So that's going to take a while if we do genuinely want to watch the place. Let's bet on a fight. And the fights are basically, as you would expect, two people fighting against each other. We have gladiator versus peasant. Who would you like to bet on? And this is great fun. For if you're playing this on Twitch, or if anybody's thinking about playing this on Twitch, I think a fantastic option would be Twitch integration for this game, because you've probably seen at this stage there are so many options that come up, and I think the ability, because this is what I would be doing, was I'd be asking Twitch chat, who should we bet on, and then disregard Twitch chat, because Twitch chat is trying to make me lose all my money. But there is a method to this madness. This is actually the perfect fight to start with. IRL, if you were told out of the blue there's a fight between two people, one of them's a gladiator and one of them's a peasant, who would you bet on? You'd bet on the gladiator. And how much gold would you like to bet? There's a max of 5,000 of a bet, or zero to bet nothing. And we're going to win 1.5 times our bet. I'm feeling confident, but I'm also feeling wary. We'll bet 2,400. We'll bet big. The crowd roars as the two fighters emerge from either end of the arena and march ever closer. The bloodthirsty crowd watch closely, awaiting the first blow. We should have probably put down more money. So the gladiator gets a sharp strike on the peasant. Minus 21 HP for the peasant. The gladiator has 138 HP and the peasant has 62 and is now down to 41. Basically, they take it in turns to strike at each other. But in general, whoever has the highest HP is going to win. It's not strictly true. And you're going to see it's going to become a lot more complex than this as we go on. It's quite simple, but quite complex. The peasant has been kicked. Oh, the peasant's getting a hammering. He's not getting any hits in against the gladiator. The peasant is dead. peasant is vanquished forever in defeat. The crowd cheers for the victorious gladiator. Gladiator wins, and we have received 3,600 gold for our bet. So we're almost up to where we started. And this is one of the best and most enjoyable ways of making money. Now, we have a named warrior. Conan, the scholar huntsman. Or a bandit. I'm going to bet on Conan. It's saying that the max bet is 2,600. I'm going to bet 1,000. Because I'm not certain what way this is going to go. Yeah, it was probably a good idea that we didn't bet higher. The values are fairly low for all of them. Conan has already taken -4. The bandit is -6. The bandit swings for Conan, but slips and slightly misses. Conan has been hit for -18. I think our 1,000 gold is about to vanish. And Conan is dead. Well, there you go. We may have just learned that scholars are not good people to bet on. Gore, the shocked Iron Guard, or Servant Furious, Taiga, Minotaur Champion. I do like Minotaur Champions. And they have all these kind of modifiers, so a Minotaur Champion is different to just a Minotaur. I'm going to go with the Minotaur Champion. We could, you know what, we'll bet 2 grand to try and make back our lost money. Wait, does that make sense? So the Minotaur Champion has 224 HP and Gore has 89 and is down to 62 already. Servant Furious ducks a swift blow from Gore like it's nothing. The crowd cheers. Gore blocks. Some members of the crowd hold up a banner with the words, "We bet on Servant Furious, Taiga, Minotaur Champion." Somebody stayed up all night making that sign. So a bit of a hefty blow. Again, it's not guaranteed that it's going to be a swift or easy victory. The Minotaur Champion has taken a couple more hits. Gore is down to 12 and Gore is dead. So I'm going to fight out a couple more of these fights and try and get some money together. Okay, well, actually disregard what I just said. We conducted one more fight and bankrupted the arena. So there are 6 more fights scheduled, but there are no bets being taken because we have basically siphoned all of the money out of the kingdom, or out of the arena. We could begin subsidizing the arena. Now, the problem is that we can watch a Grand Champion fight, and you can double your bet on the Grand Champion. It's 1.5 for the normal fights. It's double for the Grand Champion fights, but we can't fight, or we can't bet on the Grand Champion because we have bankrupted the arena. We've taken all their money. That's just how good of a judge of a fighter I am. We will watch the Grand Champion fight. The crowd chant in near unison while the fighters emerge from the gates and pace towards each other with weapons in hand. So we have Borkvald, the reigning champion, against... is it Kartan, the hero of the storms? So they're getting some small hits in against each other. Borkvald has taken a hefty hit. He is unhealthy, so I don't know if that's great. Borkvald shouts, "I will bleed you like a pig." If you are as bad at fighting as you are ugly, I've got this in the bag. Borkvald has taken another hefty hit. I would have probably bet on Borkvald, so it's probably a good thing that we emptied out the coffers before this happened. So Borkvald holds his blade high in the air for the crowd. Now's not the time to be putting on a bit of a performance. It's a close enough combat. Borkvald is down to just 27. The crowd roar for Borkvald.
Overkill.
And an overkill happens. I'm not too sure exactly what an overkill means, but he had 27-ish hit points left, and he was hit for 61 damage. And Kartan, the Hero of the Storms, is the new champion. Vorkvold has died on the cold arena floor. The mighty Grand Champion is now... more. Maybe no more. Long live the new Grand Champion. So, Kartan, oh, look at that for a mustache. Look at that for a procedurally generated mustache. Is the new Grand Champion of Deathhold. He has won a single fight, earning him the title of Grand Champion, and hopes to prove himself and defend his title in his first title defense. So we can come back to this, and we can, we could actually hire him as a knight to serve us. We could view his titles. So 8-man tournament wins. Okay, so there's a hefty chunk of other tournaments that he can take part in. We can see his backstory. Found a magical ring in the burrow of a little rabbit. It made me powerful and strong. Pretty nice, right? That is pretty cool. That is pretty cool. Have the Grand Champion executed. So we could build housing for him. And we might do that to bestow extra prowess on him if he's quite strong, and we're happy to bet heavily on him and double our gold. I was hoping that we would get a bit more money from that. So what we will have to look at doing is changing the laws of the land. Taxes and subsidies. And we could remove the gambling tax. So the scribe notes down your demands on a scroll and heads off to action them. You have revoked the gambling tax. So plus one to public opinion. That is costing us 220 gold per land per year. So that's... we have 5 lands, so that's over 1,000. The banking tax we could make up to 110 gold per year per land if we were to implement that. You know, we will. We'll implement a banking tax. It will have our interest rate and all the benefits that we got from public opinion for lifting the gambling tax. That's gone. We might end that banking tax later on. We might just leave it on for a while. But I think we would seek to make most of our money through gambling. And there at the bottom is the tax. Tax people's tax. More tax equals more tax. Now from here, pretty much the last thing I want to do before we move on is explore the realm. I say that like this is a small option. We could be here for a while. There are 4 different areas, 4 cardinal directions. The northern lands, the eastern grasslands, the southern lands, and the western lands. And there are a number of regions in each of these which we could visit. I believe there's maybe up to like 40 or 50 regions, or maybe, I don't know what the number is, but let's pretend it's 40 or 50 per region. And only a selection of them are going to appear each run. So it's not like you can always bank on for definite. There are some buildings that will definitely show up in each of the 4 regions each run, but then others are kind of optional, and they'll appear sometimes and they won't appear other times. Somebody visited my court and told me something about the Northern Lands, which I've completely forgotten. Let's take a visit to the Northern Lands. And people who've played this game a lot will know that there are certain buildings that appear definitely in certain areas, and they will try and find those buildings quickly because they're really powerful. I'm just going to wander around. So we head to the Near North. The Near North is a cold place, though mild. Compared to the rest of the north, the place is filled with forts and places of violence, such as the Brawler's Pit and the Thick Blood Tavern. So we have 3 chances to explore. So we press 1, and we make our first chance, and we found a Slaver's Fort. Well, there you go. Let's go and visit the Slaver's Fort. You arrive at the Slaver's Fort. There are many men and slaves here. The fort is guarded by an army of slavers and slave soldiers, and all around you see rich merchants and petty lords bargaining for slaves. There are 1,000. There are 1,000 slaves and 500 slave soldiers. I forget what the numbers. There's 1,600 men garrisoned here if we wanted to attack them. I forget what the number is. I think if you've more slave soldiers than actual soldiers, there's a chance that they will rebel and try and overthrow you. There's a very specific threshold that if you reach... so if you were to go out into battle and too many of your soldiers died, then you might end up with a rebellion. We'll talk to the slaver to begin with. You went through the great hall of the Slaver's Fort. The room is full of slaves, hard at work cleaning and maintaining the hall, which itself is a marvel to behold. In the center of the room, the Slaver Master sits menacingly on a black marble throne. We will talk to him. So we could... we'll ask him his name. My name is not common knowledge, nor shall it be. That's probably wise. That's probably wise. So we could hire slaves, offer to buy the operation for 85,000 gold. We could demand that he shut it down. But, you know, for now, we'll speak to a random slaver. I remember once capturing a boat full of refugees from a recently destroyed kingdom. Best payout I ever had. Dear God, this place is terrible. Dear God. Dear God. The slave master calls in two slaves and orders them to fight. The court crowds around and the two slaves spend no time waiting before charging into each other violently. And we actually have a battle. These can take a while because they can't deal much damage. But they have a hefty amount of HP to get down through. So there's bone-shattering punches. It does look like Iodan is going to come out on top. The fight is finally over. The winner of the fight is Iodan, the Trodden. We could learn about the history. There are so many of these curated buildings throughout the world. You saw that there's, I think, at least 30 per region. And there's many, many more that aren't actually appearing in this run. Right, let's get some... we'll buy some slaves. One of the slavers approaches and asks how many you would like to buy. There are a total of 1,000 at 3 gold each. We can afford all 1,000 of them. We will go for 100. We won't go mad. We won't go mad, says the man who's just after hiring 100 slaves. We will hire some soldiers. We have enough for all 500 of them. I think we will again take 100. We could possibly have taken more. Those numbers might replenish by the next time that we are back. We will continue adventuring around. You pass by a deranged-looking farmer who's bloodied and barefoot. Approaches your envoy and hands you a strange-looking black orb. You examine it for a moment, but when you gaze up, the farmer is gone. We have a chaos orb. This is a weapon that we can kind of, well, we can kind of use it in battle to cause bedlam and mayhem. So that was one of our two... our three chances to explore. Sometimes nothing happens. You find a wandering group of 5 desperate-looking warriors. One of them steps forward and says the men will join you for no less than 8 gold each. Hire them. And we have 0 chances to explore this turn. Very quickly, I'm just going to look at managing our staff and champions. So we have a head diplomat. We could hire a spymaster, a court jester, and a steward. I'm going to see about hiring a spymaster. So 3 potential spymasters are sent to your court. You may speak to each of them to learn of their skills and talents. So we have Lox the Mortal, Helfrey the Sad, and Siren Black Eyes. Information I have found has saved lives. I had references, but an ogre ate my parchment. I request 84 gold per year. Yes. An ogre ate my homework. So 84 to hire and a skill level of 72. Siren Black Eyes. I am pretty decent at the art of spying. If you don't hire me, I'll kill myself. I demand pay of 118 gold per year. That's, there you go. That's a Tinder bio and a half. And Lox the Mortal, I am an expert in the realm of spying. You'd be stupid not to hire me. I require payment of 109. Go away, you. He's probably good, though. Do you know what? He's not much better. Well, he's a bit better than, higher cost is 197. How much did he want per year? 197 per year. That is hefty. That is hefty, but he is good. I don't want to be stupid. And a good spymaster is a good position to have. So we'll hire Lox the Mortal, and maybe for Steward, we'll just see what we have. We've Aiden the Cyclops. I have read all the texts of stewardship and leadership. I am the right choice. And I used to be very poor, so I empathize with the people. I am willing to lose a limb for you. 247 gold per year. You see, these boys are pricey. These positions are pricey. 182 per year. And I might be able to get away. Reinwarg the Rat Tosser wants 140. He says he'll make the peasants love us. He's not great, though. And there you can see the traits. Kind-hearted dungeoneer. So Braith will basically throw everyone that shows up in court into the dungeon. Aiden is kind-hearted and would probably give them all money, even if he shouldn't. I'm going to hold off on hiring a steward. If we want to contact adventurers, we will need a building to do so. So here in the kingdom upgrades in guilds, I'll just go back to it a second. So it's kingdom upgrades and it's guilds and order buildings. I'm going to build, I was trying to find this for a while, an emissary hut. So that will give us an emissary that we can send out to contact the adventuring companies, which I'll do maybe on the next episode. We have productivity buildings. I'm just looking down through these quickly to see if there's anything that we can build. So we have a large nobility post. Free potato signs. 50%. Absolutely. Yeah, sure. Absolutely. So free potato signs. We give free potatoes to green friends. And that's going to increase the number of goblin slaves captured by the goblin slaver. And we will build a goblin hut as well. So that will increase the chance of goblins joining us. So we might as well get the devils to fight for us. Income buildings. As you can see, I'm desperately trying to get money together to, or not money, but troops, basically. Troops. So we could assign a personal guard to the goblin slaver, which will decrease the chance that they will get killed. We can see an artifact hall, 25,000. Throne room signs to increase the amount of people arriving to the fort. Wooden climbing picks. Climbing knights are more likely to succeed. We'll go with that personal guard for the goblin slaver. And we can continue to upgrade that by spending more and more and more money. We spent about 7 grand. Building units, getting units, hiring units. I'm coming back here for about the third time, I'd say. Because I am a bit worried about the size and strength, predominantly the strength of the army. So we'll hire some more soldiers. We have 255, so do you know what? We'll get 20. So we have now 805 men in the army. So we will see that is our year done. We have recruited, we have gambled, we have held court, we have condemned hundreds of people to slavery and to terrible life conditions for the year. We've tanked public opinion through a number of unpopular decisions. We've explored the realm. Let us now end the current year. As you prepare to move on, your head diplomat approaches you. My chief executive officer, are you sure you wish to move on? There isn't anything left to deal with that I can tell you, but you may wish to wait. I will wait off on ending the turn for now. I still wish to move on. I still wish to move on, and do not bother me with this again. So this is just to make sure, because this is basically the end of the turn. So are you sure that you want to continue? Yes. And here, at the end of the year, we get an opportunity to wage war, and indeed to have war waged against us. My chief executive officer, what are your orders? We can attack the rebels, who we are at war with. We can attack the bandit horde. We can attack the goblin kingdoms and try and take land from them. We can attack the various bandit groups that we are at war with. Or we could launch no attacks. Let's see if we're in a position to attack the rebels. I don't think we are. It's a quick battle with the least chance of casualties, a quick skirmish. We could raid their lands, plunder their goods, but with some risk. Or we could carry out a full-scale invasion to try and capture rebel land. Now, this is why we hired a spymaster. They have a fair bit of territory behind them. 9 lands that we would need to capture before their capital. They have a decent chunk of gold in their vault, so a raid is definitely worth consideration. We will raid their lands, plunder their goods, with some risk. So we don't have a big army at the moment. My chief executive officer, we need to discuss troop assignments. How many shall we send in the attacking force? So we can send all of our troops, all of the troops but the peasants, half of the troops. Half of the troops with no peasants. Or we could choose ourselves. Let's say we'll send everyone, bar the peasants. So our spymaster has done some spying. And here is the problem. Our battle score is 39,000. The rebels' battle score is 41. So they are a bit stronger than us. Good, let's crush them. I don't like the look of this. Retreat. What do you think about this? They technically outmatch us, but it's only by a thread. With any luck, we could win. So this is why we are in a position where we need to contemplate our actions for the year ahead. Let's retreat. So we have called back our forces from the rebel attack. However, we are now being told that we are being attacked by rebels. And our general is asking if we wish to watch the attack. So we have two different options. We can just say no and skip it, or we can watch the battle. We will watch the battle. We have 646 men total and 5 lands. Your men are spread equally across your land, so 159 defenders guard this one. The militia have sent 21 troops to assist the defense. So we have 180 defenders in total. A cloud-filled sky adorns the battlefield before the two armies clash. So there you saw how the kind of the militia and the size of the army impacts your defensive ability based on how many territories you have. If we were attacking, we could wait for better weather conditions, but there are no weather events during the battle due to the calm weather, and there's a 50% invasion defense battle strength bonus for us. So that's good at the least. Beneath the cloud-filled sky, the rebels charge forward and attack with not a moment to spare. So how many forces are they bringing to the battle? They're bringing 539. We've killed 44-ish. We've killed just under 50 of their forces. Some of our slave soldiers have died. So our defenses in this position are good. But they have vastly, vastly, vastly more troops than us. So they could whittle us down unless we are able to defend well. And inflict heavy casualties. They have hit us badly. The rebels managed to break through your center before forcing your army back. 25 soldiers killed. 37 peasants dead. Our army reduced to just 91 men. And another absolute decimation. So we are getting badly beaten, and there are our forces depleted to zero. The invading force of the rebels has taken one of your lands for their own. Minus one land, plus one land to the rebels. With the battle over, you are brought a battle report showing troop losses and survivors. There's not very much to look at. We could pay an egghead to make a report. We'll do that for a later one when we actually have something good. Some good news. Oh, that is bad. We lost a knight. Lost some goblins. 55 soldiers, 87 peasants, 30 slave soldiers killed. Those are terrible numbers. Those are terrible numbers. And we receive a report of the goings-on of the last year. So the good news is we didn't receive any more battles. That was the only attack that we faced. But we have been deprived of a land. It's going to be easier now to defend the rest of our kingdom. But the rebels are up to 10 chunks of land. We have suffered some hefty losses. And we can read through the report. We will read the advanced report. And we have, probably for the first time, needing to actually bring the mouse in and scroll through. So we received 240 gold in rent from our four lands, not five, because one of them was taken. 330 in tribute from the slaver, 491 from our peasants and slaves from the harvest. So the more peasants and slaves we have, the more money we will make on the harvest. 1,800 in general taxes. And all nine of our bandits flee to join the bandit horde. Well, the devils. We enlist 12 soldiers and 20 peasants have been trained into soldiers. Here are all of the wages. The bandit horde pillages for 800 gold. Notable events from the previous year. The Swine Stealers Brotherhood fight with a Deathhold patrol, but they lose. Our defensive palisades managed to prevent three raids from happening. And the militia has gained 44 new peasants this year. And we can see that some of the adventuring groups have also managed to hire mercenaries. Fenor calls a gathering of bandits. All the bandit groups in the land meet and discuss peace among the bandits. The general bandit level has risen. New bandits are taking up arms. So we might have to try and deal with the bandit horde. The rebels enlist 9 new soldiers. And they lost 108. So that's the only good news. They have enlisted 9 but lost 108. So hopefully we can start whittling them down. But it's going to be difficult to recover from our losses as well. So our total treasury has increased by 1,728 gold. And our bank account has increased by 5 in terms of interest. And we could actually customize the report if we wanted to. We will move on. A new year is dawning. The tide of time brings in the new year of 148, and with it comes a feeling of insurmountable conquest among the military. Gain 30% more strength when launching an attack this year, and for this year only, you can launch a total invasion. So I'm not too sure as that we can launch new invasions. This is definitely new. The last time I played, there was not this screen at the start telling you things about the year ahead. So there might just be an issue with that at the moment. Press any key to continue. And we are into a brand new year. Years remaining, 24, men, 649. Our gold is depleted. Our public opinion is low. Our lands have been reduced from 5 to 4. The kingdom, the company, is in crisis. Can we get the forces together with which to defend it? Can we get some troops together to mount an attack against the rebels? Dealing with the rebels quickly is going to be important. Now they have 9, they have 10 territories, so that's going to be a bit of an issue. With the type of gameplay and with the type of career path that I've chosen, a constant war and actually stripping land off of our enemies isn't exactly massively important. If we were fighting for the demonic overlord, that is absolutely what the goal would be. But there we go. Mixed results for year one of the new corporate structure that rules Deathhold. I'm going to put some links below in the description to the Reddit, the subreddit for this. Absolute lunacy. Go and check it out. Some of the things that can pop up there are insane. I'll put a link to Hugh's YouTube channel down below as well. He's been posting videos on some of the kind of the secrets and some of the more bizarre and deranged aspects of the game, of which there are plenty. So you can kind of get an idea of some of the really fun and weird things that you can do. Do go and check those out. If for no other reason than having Hugh face the monster that he has created and having him find and react to some of the bugs and some of the spelling mistakes that might pop up from time to time. Blind did an interview with him at one stage, and I think it is called The Day That /Programming Humor Stood Still. This entire game is stored in a single file. It is multiple tens of thousands of lines long. Even the code for this game is a work of pure insanity. And it is fun. Hugh actually finds it easier to code that way because he can just kind of do a control F and find things very quickly instead of needing to jump between files to try and find an issue if one is ever reported. So you can actually see an argument in favor of that. But I'll post some links below to some insanity and lunacy connected to this game, and I'll post a link to the Steam page if you're interested in picking this up yourself. I've had fantastic fun with it so far, and I have no doubt that I will continue to have fantastic fun with it as we go forward and try and pull Deathhold out of the unfortunate position that it finds itself in. Thank you for joining me on this episode, and I hope that I won't find you in a slaver's camp on the next one. Because if I do, I'm recruiting you.